So welcome everybody. I'm supposed to sum up exercise one and respond to some of the questions. So I'll continue with that. If you recall, we started with this question as to whether this basic need of every human being, the need for continuous happiness, is it something, an innate nature, or is it something which is an influence from outside? So that was the basic question we started. So this was the basic question that we started with. And we said that if you look at the approach that most of us have been taking regarding ensuring this continuity of happiness has been in terms of some favorable influence from outside as the source of happiness. Largely, if you see, it is either in terms of getting the favorable sensation through the body or getting the right feeling or the favorable feelings from the other. So this seems to be the major source of happiness for us. And we argued out that these two cannot be the source of continuous happiness. They can at the most be a source of temporary happiness or rather excitement. We also said that this happiness, this continuous happiness, is an innate nature of we as human being. So we have been trying to work into it, investigate into this proposal. And in order to do this, we found that this happiness can be ensured by way of right understanding in this self, by way of right feeling and right thought in this self, and by way of developing the competence to live in relationship, in harmony, in coexistence with the world around. So that is what we have been trying to investigate. So this right understanding and then right feeling and right thought is what is the basis of happiness, what can be the source of continuous happiness, source of continuous happiness for each one of us. So in order to ensure this right understanding, the right feeling and right thought, we said that we need to look into our own existence as a human being with all its expanse. And therefore, we try to investigate into our existence as a human being. And we said that we as human being live with, you know, within the self, with the people around, and ultimately the whole nature and existence. and therefore we need to understand the existence as a whole. And this existence can be seen in terms of the coexistence, in terms of units in space. And when we look at this units, they are largely, you know, can be seen in terms of the material units and the consciousness units. So basically, we have to investigate into these three basic realities: the material units, the consciousness units, and the coexistence. Coexistence of these units in space. So that is what we said, we have to investigate into these three basic realities: the material unit, the consciousness unit, and the coexistence. We also said that because it is the self, it is the consciousness, which is going to see things, understand things, and therefore we have to investigate into the self, into the consciousness first. Then we can investigate into the material units, and ultimately we can investigate into the coexistence. So that was the sequence in which we said we will start working. So in exercise one, we said we'll investigate into this self by the self. In exercise two, we will investigate into the material unit, particularly the body. And of course, this investigation has to be made by the self. And ultimately, in exercise three, we will investigate into the coexistence by the self. So in that context, we were working on exercise one, which is basically observing the self by the self. Now, after having worked on this exercise one for some time and introducing all these seven possible steps for doing this investigation, let us look back and see what we have talked about and what are the important observations. Number one, we have been able to see that it is possible to see the self by the self. It is possible to observe the self by the self without referring to the body, without taking help of the body. That is to say that when I'm observing myself, and we said one of the simplest way of observing the self is observing the imagination of the self, imagination that is going on in the self every moment. So observing the imagination, the desire, thought, expectation, which is going on in the self every moment. And this imagination I can observe directly without taking help of the eyes or taking help of the body. And therefore we said that we can give rest to the eyes, we can give rest to the body, and start directly observing our imagination, the imagination of the self which is going on by the self. So this observation of the self by the self can be done directly without taking help of the body. So this is one important, you know, thing that we observed. When we started observing the imagination, the self, it was little difficult. Many of us felt that, you know, we are not able to see our thought, or even when we are able to see our thought sometime, we are not able to see our desire, which is at the base of this thought. We are not able to see the feeling which is giving rise to this thought. So all those difficulty was there, but slowly I think most of us are able to see, if not every moment, at least sometime we are able to see that yes, there is some thought going on. And we are also able to see that yes, at the base of that thought there is some desire, there is some feeling. I may not be able to see it every moment, but whenever I am paying attention, I am able to see it. So this has become possible for us to see the imagination which is going on in the self whenever we are paying attention. So this is an important shift, I would say, because till now we have been paying attention outside. We have been observing the world outside. At the most, we have been observing the body and what is going on in the body in terms of the sensation. But now we are able to see the self. We are able to see the activity which is going on in the self. We are able to see the imagination that is there in the self and which is going on. So this is a very important shift, I would say. We will also observe that when we are observing this self by the self, we are absorbed with the self. Most of us would have been able to feel this, that when I'm observing this self by the self and I'm busy with this observation, I'm not even aware of the body. If I have to be aware of the body, then I have to pay attention to the body, to the sensation of the body by choice, by decision. So this is the after reflection. Once you start paying attention to the self, once you are able to see the self, at least in terms of the imagination going on in the self, then you can look back and see that, you know, when you are busy with the self, you have to decisively pay attention to the body, to see the body, to see the sensation of the body. So coming back to observing the self by the self, we said the simplest way is to observe the imagination. Imagination that is anyway going on in the self. So we started with that. We said to begin with, in step one, all that I have to do is to become aware, become observant of my own imagination, becoming aware of the desires, the thoughts, the expectation which is going on in me at this moment. So I begin with this moment. At this moment, whatever thought is going on, whatever is feeling is there at the base of that thought, I start observing that. So I am being aware of that imagination, that feeling, that thought which is going on in me at this moment of time. So this is the first step. Few observations that we made about step one is that while we are observing our imagination, our feeling, our thought, we just have to observe it without any reaction, without evaluating it, whether it is right or wrong, without trying to have the continuity of it or trying to remove it. We just have to observe. We just have to observe without any reaction. So this is one important thing we said. Second important thing we said about this step one is that we have to observe it at this moment. We have to observe it at the next moment. And ultimately, we have to observe it at every moment. So this is another important thing. So in a sense, we are saying that we have to observe our imagination every moment. We have to observe the feeling, the thought that is going on every moment. So we start with this moment, we observe the next moment, and then ultimately we observe every moment. While we are observing it, we are not reacting to it. We are not evaluating it. We are not trying to remove it or have the continuity of it. Whatever is going on, I am just observing. And observing it without reaction. And that is it. We said that this observation of the imagination, of the feeling, of the thought, without reaction, is something very simple, but very important. It is simple because we have the capacity to observe, we have the capacity to see, we have the capacity to pay attention. And therefore, whenever we decide to pay attention, we are able to pay attention to something which is there in reality, like the self. When we pay attention, we are able to observe, we are able to see, and when we see it, we are able to understand. So all this is, this capability, this potentiality is already there in us. Only thing is that we have not been paying attention to it. So whenever we decide to pay attention, we are able to pay attention to this reality, one of the reality being the self. So whenever we pay attention, we are able to see, and whenever we are able to see, we are able to understand. So in that sense, it is very simple. It is very important in the sense that, as we saw in step 2 and 3, my happiness or unhappiness depends upon the feeling that I have at this moment. So whenever I have a feeling which is naturally acceptable to me, I am in a state of harmony and happiness with that feeling. Whenever I have a feeling, even for a moment, which is not naturally acceptable to me, which is not natural to me, then I am in a state of disharmony, in a state of contradiction within myself. I am in a state of unhappiness within myself. So my happiness or unhappiness has to do with my feeling, has to do with my thought. And therefore, it is important for me to observe my feeling, my thought, my imagination. And in order to observe, I have to be aware of it. So in that sense, we said that this step one is very simple, but it is very important. Second important thing was that when we start observing, we realize that our attention keeps going here and there. We are not able to keep observing. So next, this moment, I'm able to observe. Next moment, my attention goes somewhere else, right? So we found that our attention goes to place which we consider is important. It goes to things around which we have considered important. So whatever we consider important, we pay attention to it. So if that happens, we don't have to worry. We only have to see that my attention is going to some X because I have considered this to be important. And all that I have to decide is that the self is also important. This imagination in this self is also important. This feeling is also important because this is the basic source of happiness or unhappiness for me. So if I can see this, then I can decide to get back to paying attention to my feeling, my thought. And this decision itself is enough. So if I take the decision, my attention will automatically come back to my imagination, come back to my feeling. This we have been able to see. So through this exercise one, we are able to see that if we can see that self is important, the imagination going on in the self is important, the feeling is important, then our attention starts going to the self, to the imagination, to the feeling. So like that, we had many such, you know, questions or issues coming in, and then we were able to get the answer and resolve it, right? And the important thing is that we are able to get these answers by our direct experience. We are able to see all these things by ourselves, by direct observation. So effectively, we found that if we decide to pay attention to the self, to the imagination of the self, to the feeling of the self, it is possible for us to observe, to see this imagination, this feeling which is going on in the self. So this was step one. And we have been saying a number of times that this step one is a very simple but very important step. But we also find that when we go through these other steps, the higher steps, right? Every time we keep coming back to step one. And when we come back to step one, our observation is much deeper, much finer than it was before. So this step one is like an anchor. Right? It is an anchor which is supporting the whole exercise of observing the self by the self. So it can be very gross thing to do with, to begin with, but as we go on, it becomes finer and finer, right? Subtler and subtler. So this one, step one, is very significant, very important. And we have to keep working with this step one. So one of the important outcome of this step one has been that when I'm working with step one, I am able to see my desire, my thought, my expectation. I am able to see my feeling in particular, the feeling that I have at this moment. And once I am able to see this feeling, this thought which is going on in me, in the self, then it is possible for me to work with the higher steps. So this is what we have been working with, step one of exercise one. Now, once we are able to do this, then we can move on to this step two and three. In step two, we are saying that let us look at this feeling which I have at this moment, and let us ask ourselves whether this feeling is naturally acceptable to me or not naturally acceptable to me. Can we go to this slide, previous slide? Bihari Nandan ji? Yeah, this. Yeah. No, this last one that you saw. Yes. So this feeling I have at this moment, is it naturally acceptable to me? Is it in accordance with human nature? Would I like to have the continuity of it? And in step three, we are asking that with this feeling, the feeling that I have at this moment, am I comfortable within or uncomfortable within? Am I in a state of harmony within or a state of contradiction within? Am I in a state of happiness within or state of unhappiness within? So this is what we are doing in step two and step three. So if you put it together, in step one, we are trying to observe the feeling, the imagination, the feeling that we have at this moment. In step two, we are trying to see whether this feeling is naturally acceptable to me or not naturally acceptable to me. In step three, I am asking whether this feeling leads to a state of harmony and happiness within, or a state of contradiction and unhappiness within. So these three steps together gives me the clarity that number one, I can observe my feeling, my thought every moment. Number two, if I have a feeling which is naturally acceptable to me, then I'm in a state of harmony and happiness with it. If I have a feeling which is not naturally acceptable to me, even for a moment, then I am in a state of contradiction, in a state of unhappiness within. So my happiness or unhappiness depends upon the feeling that I have at this moment. So if you recall, we said that this state of happiness or unhappiness is basically an innate nature of myself. It is not something which I have to derive under the influence of the world outside. So you can get a glimpse of this, that when I have the right feeling, when I have the feeling which is natural to me, I am in a state of harmony and happiness within, right? Irregard of what is the condition outside. Irregard of the condition of the body, irregard of the behavior of the other person, irregard of the physical condition of the world outside. So you can start getting a glimpse of this, that this happiness, this continuous happiness is the innate nature of the self and not an influence from outside. So I think I'll kind of sum up these three steps, 1, 2, and 3. And then if there are any questions in this context, in the context of these three steps, I'll respond to it. So I'll sum up saying that in the first three steps, I'm able to observe my imagination, my feeling, my thought that is going on in me. Then I'm able to observe that this feeling is the source of my happiness or unhappiness. If I have a feeling which is naturally acceptable to me, then I'm in a state of harmony and happiness. If there is a feeling, even for a moment, which is not naturally acceptable to me, I'm in a state of contradiction and unhappiness. So, this is the essence of first three steps. The important thing, again, I'll de-emphasize, is that I can see the self directly by the self without referring to the body, without referring to the eyes. And if I can set my feeling in order, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness in regard of the condition outside. Yes. So this is the essence of what we have been able to see in first three steps. So let me sum up these other four steps that we have been talking about. Yesterday I summed up these first three steps. Okay. In step one, we are trying to be aware of our own self, trying to be conscious, observant of our own self. And while being conscious of our own self, we said we can observe our own imagination. We can observe our desire, thought, and expectation that is going on each one of us. And while observing, we said two things we have to keep in mind. Number one, when I'm observing my imagination, I just have to observe it without evaluating, without reacting. So whatever is going on in me, in my imagination at this moment, I just have to be aware. I just have to be observant. I just have to be mindful of it. And that's it. And this I have to do every moment. So two important things about step one, when I am being observant about my own imagination. Number one, I have to do this observation without any reaction. And number two, I have to do it every moment. Because every moment this is going on. Now, once I'm able to observe this imagination, and particularly I'm able to observe the feeling that is going on in this imagination, in step two, I have to ask myself whether this feeling is naturally acceptable to me or not naturally acceptable to me. A very simple question to ask. This feeling I have at this moment, is it naturally acceptable to me? Is it not naturally acceptable to me? So is it natural? Is it unnatural? The other way to verify it is asking this question, whether I want the continuity of this feeling or I do not want the continuity of this feeling. So So I can see whether this feeling is naturally acceptable or not naturally acceptable. In step three, I am asking whether with this feeling, I am in a state of comfortableness or uncomfortable. Am I in a state of harmony or state of contradiction within? With this feeling, am I in a state of happiness within or unhappiness within? So I am asking this question to myself, that with this feeling which I have at this moment, am I in a state of harmony and happiness within or otherwise? So these three steps in very brief is, number one, I am observing my feeling, my imagination, and particularly my feeling. Then step two, I am asking this question whether this feeling is naturally acceptable to me, not naturally acceptable to me. In step three, I am asking whether it leads to happiness or unhappiness within. So this is what we had summed up yesterday. Now the important conclusion of these first three steps, you know, is that a natural feeling in me leads to a state of harmony and happiness. An unnatural feeling in me leads to disharmony and unhappiness. So this is a very important conclusion. You know, what we were calling as law of consciousness is one important law of consciousness, that a natural feeling leads to a state of harmony and happiness within. An unnatural feeling leads to disharmony, contradiction, and unhappiness within. Now with this, now in step four, we started asking this question, that given this law that a natural feeling leads to harmony and happiness, and an unnatural feeling leads to disharmony and unhappiness. Now, the feeling I have at this moment, and which is leading to my happiness or unhappiness, right? Who is taking the decision for this feeling? Because I want to be happy every moment. Okay. And if I look at myself, I find that I'm sometimes happy, sometimes unhappy. And on the basis of first three steps, now I can see that a natural feeling leads to happiness and unnatural feeling leads to unhappiness. So I can see this feeling is, you know, deciding my happiness or unhappiness. So the question is that who is deciding for this feeling? Who is taking the decision for this feeling that I have at this moment? So this is the question we are asking in step four. That given this feeling in me at this moment of time, I'm asking myself, who is taking the decision, or who has taken the decision for this feeling? Is it some condition outside? Is it some other body's, you know, somebody's behavior outside? Or is it that ultimately I have taken the decision myself? So these are three possibilities. So if somebody shouted at me, and this example we have been taking so many times, if somebody is shouting me at me and I feel, you know, angry on him, so this feeling of anger or this feeling of opposition which I have in me at this moment of time, and which is leading to disharmony and unhappiness within, who has taken this decision for this feeling? Is it this other person shouting outside? Or given that the other person shouting outside, I have taken the decision to have a feeling of opposition or have a feeling of relationship for the other. To have a feeling of opposition or a feeling of pity for the other. this example we have discussed many times, right? So if you look at this, and we have been doing this investigation for last 1 month, we can see that given this condition outside, I still have the choice to decide for a feeling of relationship or a feeling of opposition, a feeling of, you know, anger or a feeling of pity on the other. That possibility is always there. So the end result of this is that given any external situation, either physical or somebody else's behavior, ultimately it is me who is taking the decision for my feeling. So this situation outside can at the most trigger some process in me. So somebody is shouting at me, now this has triggered a process within me. But what feeling I will decide for ultimately depends upon me. For the same situation outside, I have the choice to decide for different feelings. So if I can see that this person outside is in trouble and therefore he is shouting, then I will have a feeling of pity for him. On the other hand, if I feel or I think that this person is trying to harm me or damage me or insult me, right, and he is enjoying doing it, then I am likely to have the feeling of opposition. The same situation outside, but my feeling is decided by me, right? And this feeling may be very different, you know, depending upon how I see things. So the important conclusion of step 4 is that given any situation outside, it is me ultimately who is deciding for my feeling. And because I am deciding for my feeling, and this feeling gives rise to happiness or unhappiness, therefore, I am responsible for my happiness or unhappiness, my harmony or disharmony. And if I can see this over, you know, period of time, I can conclude that yes, I am responsible for my feeling every moment. And therefore, I'm also responsible for my happiness or unhappiness every moment. So I'm 100% responsible for my happiness or unhappiness. This is another important law of consciousness, which we must realize. So I am the master of my feeling. I am the master of my happiness or unhappiness. And this is a very important realization. If I can see this, then there are two very important conclusions which I can draw. Number one is that if I am responsible for my unhappiness or happiness, and I want to be, you know, in a state of happiness in continuity, then I have to work on myself. I have to work on improving myself. And that is what we are trying to do, right? We have to work on ourselves. We have to improve ourselves. You know, we have to understand this, you know, thing that is going on in me in terms of my feeling, in terms of my understanding, in terms of my response, in terms of my reaction and all that. I have to understand. And I have to improve upon myself. This is one important conclusion. The other important conclusion is that till now I thought that the things outside are responsible for my happiness or unhappiness. And therefore, I was holding these things outside responsible, whether the other person or the situation, the physical situation. And therefore, I had a lot of complaints, particularly a lot of complaints against the people. You know, people outside, people in the family. You know, I have a lot of complaints because I think that I am unhappy because of these people. But now I can see that I am responsible for my happiness or unhappiness. And therefore, I have to work on myself. So two things will happen. Number one, I will start working on myself. I will be willing to change myself, transform myself, improve myself. And number two, I will be free of complaints for the other. So we have a lot of complaints from others. Now we will not have complaint for others. We will, you know, try to improve ourselves. And we will also be able to realize that these people who are, you know, doing ill action are in trouble themselves. So I have to be help to them rather than, you know, complaining to what they are doing. So I'll work on improving myself and I will be willing to help the other to improve themselves. So these two important, you know, outcomes, important conclusion can be drawn from step 4. Now, once I am able to see that it is me who is deciding the feeling, right? A natural movement is to step 5. Now, once I see that it is me who is deciding the feeling that I have in me and which is the cause of my happiness or unhappiness, now it is natural for me to ask this question as to what is the basis on which I am taking the decision about my feeling. So what basis do I decide my feeling, my thought every moment? And particularly at this moment. Do I decide it on the basis of my understanding? Or I decide it on the basis of the assumption which I have in the absence of the understanding? So what is the basis? The basis is understanding of the reality about which I am deciding my feeling. Or when I have the lack of understanding, there is some assumption about that reality. So I am deciding that on the basis of, you know, that assumption, that the condition. And this is a very important thing to observe because when I ask this question to myself, I can see that if I am deciding my feeling on the basis of my understanding about that reality, then I decide in favor of a natural feeling with definiteness. So we have taken many examples. So when I can understand myself as a human being, I can understand the other human being as a human being. When I can see that I have my natural acceptance, the other person also has a natural acceptance. We both have the natural acceptance for the right feeling. So now I can see, and with that right feeling, the natural feeling, I am in a state of harmony and happiness. If I can see all this, then I will have a feeling of relationship for everybody around. So the right understanding of myself and the other human being will lead to a feeling of relationship for the other. On the other hand, if I do not understand myself as a human being, I do not understand the other as a human being, and I have made some assumption about myself, about the other, then my feeling will depend upon the assumption, the preconditioning that I have. Now, if this preconditioning, this assumption is right, then I will have a natural feeling. If it is not right, I may have an unnatural feeling. So, for example, if I feel that I am related to people in my family, I will have a feeling of relationship for them. If I feel that I am not related to the people outside my family, I am likely to have a feeling of relationship or opposition. So that is not definite. So whenever I end up having a wrong feeling, unnatural feeling, this is because of my assumption about myself or the other person, assumption which is not right. So this is an important observation, that when I'm taking the decision about my feeling towards any reality, am I doing it on the basis of my right understanding or on the basis of my assumption about that reality in the absence of my understanding of it? The important conclusion that is drawn out of this is that the definiteness of my feeling, my natural feeling, will come only with the right understanding of reality. And therefore, I need to have the right understanding about myself, about the other, and ultimately the whole existence, because that is, you know, what I'm living with. So that right understanding is important. Okay, to take the decision in favor of the right feeling towards any given reality. So this is what we tried to observe, and we are still observing it. So this is another important law of consciousness, that with right understanding only I can take the decision in favor of the right feeling with definiteness. And with right feeling only, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness. So now we can see that to ensure happiness within myself, number one, I have to have the right understanding about the reality with which I'm relating to. And number two, I have to have the right feeling. And this is what we have been saying right from the beginning, that source of happiness is right understanding and right feeling in the self. Now this we can see here in step 5, by direct observation. So this is step 5. Now once this is clear that we have to have the right understanding about the reality with which I am interacting, and we have to have the right feeling, you know, about the reality with which we are interacting. In step 6, we are trying to find out what are the feelings which are natural to us and what are the feelings which are not natural to us. So this is what we are doing in 6A. So in 6A, we are asking, which feeling is naturally acceptable to me? The feeling of relationship or feeling of opposition? Feeling of disharmony, contradiction, or feeling of harmony? Similarly, feeling of coexistence or feeling of struggle? So these are the three broad possibilities of my feeling. Feeling of relationship or opposition, feeling of harmony or disharmony, feeling of coexistence or struggle. These are the very broad feelings that, you know, is of importance. Then we can work out the finer details of it. But let us settle this broad feeling, you know. And it is important, because if we can settle this, then we can ensure this within ourselves, because we are the one who are taking decisions. So 6A, we are asking this question. Which feeling is naturally acceptable to me? And this we can verify for ourselves. And this is what we have been doing for last 1 month or so. Okay. Trying to find out which feeling is naturally acceptable to me. The feeling of relationship or opposition, harmony or contradiction, coexistence or struggle. And we are able to verify by direct observation that it is the feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence which is naturally acceptable to me and not otherwise. Right. So this is another important law. It says it is the feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence which is naturally acceptable to me and not otherwise. And once I'm able to see this, the step 7A is very simple, just the extension of it, that if I can see that this relation, feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence is what is naturally acceptable to me, and therefore it will lead to a state of harmony and happiness. So simple thing for me to do is to ensure that at this moment of time, I have the feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, and not otherwise. That's what we are doing in step 7A. So step 6A, we are able to see that it is the feeling of relationship, harmony, coexistence, which is naturally acceptable to us, to me. In step 7A, we are just trying to ensure that at this moment, we have this feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence, not otherwise. And if I can ensure this at this moment, that I have the feeling of relationship, harmony, coexistence, and not otherwise, then I can be in harmony within, and therefore in a state of happiness within at this moment. So at this moment, I can ensure to be in a state of harmony and happiness. And if I can do it at this moment and next moment, and every moment, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness every moment. And that is the source of continuous happiness for me. So through these seven steps, I can do my self-investigation. I can find out what leads to my state of happiness and unhappiness. I can see what are the natural feelings, what are the unnatural feelings. And ultimately, every moment I can ensure the feeling which are natural to me and therefore ensure the state of harmony and happiness. So in a sense, this is what we have been doing in exercise one. I have not talked about step 6B and step 7B that I'll take up tomorrow. But in a sense, I would say that these are the seven steps through which we are trying to work on our own self, for our own self-improvement, for ensuring the state of harmony and happiness within in continuity. So what I would do is I will complete this 6B and 7B before I get to other questions. So yesterday we had talked about this, you know, step 1 to step 5. And then we talked about step 6A and 7A. So I will just repeat that in, you know, few minutes and then talk about the 6B and 7B. So step 1, we said we have to be observant. We have to be aware. We have to be mindful of our own self. We have to be aware of whatever is going on in me in terms of my imagination, in terms of my desired thought and expectation, in terms of my feeling. Right. So at this moment, I have to be observant. I have to see what is going on in me in terms of my imagination, in terms of my desire, thought, and expectation, in terms of my feeling, my thought. And then we said two things. Number one, we have to do this without reaction, and we have to do it every moment. So what I was explaining just now, this step one is the most important step. We will start with step one, then go on to step two, three, four, and so on. And I was saying they will just start happening. If I am doing step one properly, then other steps will start happening. But to begin with, we have to do it, you know, with effort. And when we go from step one to seven, we come back to step one. Right? But now this step one has more depth than it had before. So we will start with step one, now with more depth, then go on to step two, three, four, and so on till seven, and then we come back to this step one with more depth. So that's how things will start happening, with more depth and with more continuity. So when I start observing the feeling, the thought that I have at this moment, the step two will start happening. I will be able to observe the feeling at this moment. And I will also be able to see whether this feeling is naturally acceptable to me or not. Whether I want the continuity of this feeling or I don't want the continuity of this feeling. So this will start happening. Similarly, step three will start happening. I will be able to see whether with this feeling I'm in a state of harmony and happiness or state of contradiction and unhappiness. Am I feeling comfortable within or uncomfortable within? So step one, if I do, you know, properly, step two and step three will start happening. To begin with, we have to do it with effort. So that is what we have been doing. You know, we are trying to do it with effort. But as I said, as you go on, you will see that step one will automatically lead to step two and step three. Similarly, step four will start happening. I will be able to see that when I'm able to see my feeling from the place of pure observer, and I'm able to decide whether it is naturally acceptable or not, whether it is leading to a state of harmony and happiness or disharmony and unhappiness, my feelings start getting sorted out. The feeling which are not natural, which is leading to unhappiness, will not continue. They are continuing because I have not, you know, observed it and I have not decided whether it is worth continuing or not worth continuing. So if I can see in step two that this feeling is not something which I want to continue with, then I will not continue with it. I am continuing with it because I am not able to see that it is not a feeling which I want to have the continuity. It is a feeling which is leading to, you know, unhappiness. So if I can see this, it will change. So I can see that it is me who is taking the decision for my feeling, not the conditions outside, not the other human being. So step four will start happening. Step 5 will start happening where I am able to see that if I have the right understanding, if I am able to see things as they are, right? If I am able to see my relationship with other units, then, you know, in a very natural manner, I will have the right feeling for them. Only when I do not have the, you know, right understanding of it, and I'm going by some assumption, that I might decide for a feeling which is not naturally acceptable to me. So step 5 will start happening. Step 6A, of course, will start happening because I can see this, that it is the feeling of relationship which is naturally acceptable to me and not the opposition and so on, right? So I can see that what is naturally acceptable to me is the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. And if I can see this, 7A will anyway start happening because I'm able to see that this is what is naturally acceptable to me, and therefore, you know, this is what I want the continuity of. Therefore, I will have the continuity of it. So that is how things will start happening from step 1 to step 7. 6A and 7A. Now, if I bring in this 6B and 7B, what it is saying is that the important thing is to see and to understand. That is important. So 6B, we are saying that we have to see this relationship, you know, in all details and understand this relationship. Similarly, we have to see this harmony in all details and we have to understand it. And all this seeing has to be done ultimately at the level of pure observer or under the guidance of this pure observer. Similarly, we have to see this coexistence, right, in all details at the level of pure observer. So we have to see it and we have to understand it. When we see it and understand it, then it becomes clear to us that what is there in existence, in nature, is this relationship, harmony, and coexistence. So it is not something I have to create. It is something which I have to understand. Understand, and when I understand it, I am with it, you know, I can be with it. So 6B is to understand this relationship, harmony, and coexistence in all its detail, you know, at the level of pure observer or under the guidance of the pure observer. And once I am able to see it, I am being with it, that is 7B. So I can see, when I am able to understand relationship, harmony, and coexistence completely, then I will be able to decide my feeling accordingly, and I will always be comfortable within, in a state of harmony and happiness in continuity. So 6B has to be done with effort. 7B will start happening naturally. So if you look at this whole thing, step 1 is very significant. That is the place where I have to keep working. And other things will start happening up to 6A and 7A. Then I have to work for 6B. That is, I have to work for understanding, you know, this relationship, harmony, and coexistence in all its detail, at the level of pure observer or under the guidance of the pure observer. So if 6B I am working, 7B will start taking place in a very natural manner. So this is in essence what we have been talking about, you know, exercise one and exercise two. So last 1 month, we have been talking about exercise one, and this is the sum up of exercise one. I will take up the question tomorrow and then kind of make some observations about this exercise one, that is observing the self by the self. And as a result of this observation of the self by the self and understanding the self, we can start operating, you know, at the level of self. So self becomes central to my existence as a human being. I'm operating at the level of self. And through self, as and when necessary, I'm referring to the body. I'm using it as an instrument. But at the center is the self, not the body, not the physical facility. So I am the self. And my central, you know, part of the existence as human being is at the level of self. And I'm referring to the body or taking help of the body as and when I feel necessary. So this is by choice. So my existence is centered around the self, not around the body, and of course not around the physical facility. So this is what we can see when we, you know, properly work with exercise one, that is observing the self by the self. Yes. So unless there is some very urgent question, I will switch over to the Hindi session. Thank you very much. So what I would do is, rather than taking some more sharings or questions, I'll just try to sum up these 7 steps that I had already summed up yesterday, but I will do it today and close my, you know, from my side, this discussion or the summing up. If there are some questions are left, I can take up in the Hindi session. So we have around 15 minutes. I'll sum up in 15 minutes and then come back. So if you can ask questions in Hindi, I'll respond to it there in Hindi. Okay. So yesterday we said that in a sense, if you look at this, observing the self by the self, exercise one, we said this is very important. Till now we have been paying attention to the world outside. But slowly we realized, while going through the, you know, introductory sessions or otherwise in UHV, we realized that, you know, this is, as far as human being is concerned, the body is important, but self is also important. We also realized that self is more important than the body, because self is using the body as an instrument. Right? And we also said that if you look at the need of human being, it's basically the need for continuous happiness, which is the need of the self. And this need of the self is fulfilled by right understanding and right feeling and right thought, which is the activities of the self. So in that sense, the self is central to human existence. So we had all those proposals and we were trying to verify, and we prima facie felt that this sounds to be true. But then it is important to see, you know, see by direct observation all this. So we tried to see the self. We tried to see what is going on in the self. We also tried to see how the happiness, which is the basic need of the self, is dependent on the feeling in the self, right? And therefore, by setting our feeling in order, we can ensure being in a state of harmony and happiness within. So all this we try to see by direct observation, right? Number one, we as the self desire for happiness and its continuity. We were able to see that we as the self has some activities going on in the self, particularly the imagination. And when we looked at the imagination, we found that this imagination is constituted of the desire, thought, and expectation. So there are some feelings, there are some thoughts, and this is what this imagination is all about. We were also able to see by direct observation that whenever I have a feeling which is naturally acceptable to me, I am in a state of harmony and happiness. The moment I have a feeling which is not naturally acceptable to me, I am in a state of disharmony, state of contradiction, state of unhappiness. So this was our direct observation. Then through step 4 and 5, we were also able to see that when we have the right understanding, we are sure to have the right feeling and right thought, and therefore being in a state of harmony and happiness. If we do not have the right understanding, then we go by some preconditioning, some presumption, some belief about the reality. And there we have the chance of having the right feeling or wrong feeling, being in a state of harmony or disharmony, happiness or unhappiness. So this also we were able to see by direct experience, that with right understanding, I can have the right feeling and right thought. With right feeling, natural feeling, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness. So if I have the right understanding for the whole, of human existence, from self to entire existence, then I can be with the feeling which is natural for me, for every unit in existence. And with that feeling, natural feeling, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness and continuity. So all those proposals which we were able to, pay attention to about the self, about the body, about the relationship of the self with the body, about the need of the self as happiness, as continuous happiness, and its fulfillment by way of right understanding, right feeling, and right thought in the self. All those things we have been able to, start observing directly. I would not say that the process is complete or over. It is the, at least the process is on. Process is on to observe the self directly, observe the need of the self directly, observe how this, state of the self depends on the feeling I have at this moment, and how this feeling is based on the understanding, right, or lack of it. So if I can see all this, then I also get the clue that if I can ensure the right feeling, the natural feeling at this moment, then I can be in a state of harmony and happiness. And we were also able to identify that the natural feelings are the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence, and not otherwise. And therefore, we started observing this, that if I can ensure the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence at this moment of time, then with that feeling, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness at this moment of time. So at least at this moment of time, I can observe this, verify this. And with this observation, I can extrapolate that if I can do it at this moment of time, I can also do it at the next moment of time. And therefore, I can do it for every moment of time. But this is something that has to be worked out. Right? And it certainly takes time. So what Geeta ji was asking, that I have this now, this clarity, and it has started taking place, but it keeps dropping down. I am not able to maintain the continuity. Yes, that is true. You will not be able to maintain the continuity because many realities we have not understood, and we have some preconditioning, some assumption about them, some belief about them. And those preconditioning may be right or wrong. And therefore, I am likely to get into some wrong feeling, some wrong thoughts. So that will happen. But at least I am able to get the glimpse, you know, of this possibility. I am able to see that, yes, it is possible for me to be aware of myself. It is possible for me to look at the self by direct observation. It is possible to see the feelings that I have at this moment. It is also possible to see that with the natural feeling, I mean, it is possible to see whether these feelings are natural or not natural. It is also possible to see that with natural feelings, I am in a state of harmony and happiness. Right? And if I do not have a feeling which, I mean, if I have a feeling which is not natural to me, then I get into a state of disharmony and unhappiness. So all this I can see with direct observation. Similarly, I can see that if I have the right understanding about reality, then I will have the right feeling, the natural feeling. And therefore, I can be sure of the fact that I will be in a state of harmony and happiness once I have the right understanding about the reality. So with right understanding, I can have the right feeling and right thought. And with that, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness. And in brief, we also saw that ultimately what is naturally acceptable to me is this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, and not otherwise. So if I can see this, and if I can ensure this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence at this moment of time, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness. And this is all within my capacity. And as I was saying, that if I can get this, you know, even the glimpse of it for this moment, right, I have traveled a big distance. Because I can see all this as a possibility. And then I can keep working on it and keep multiplying it. So I can work it for this moment, the next moment, and that's it. In between, I'll keep falling down because I have a whole lot of preconditionings, a whole lot of assumptions, which I'm, you know, stuffed within. So I keep falling down, but that is fine. You know, I am learning to walk on two legs. So it takes time. I keep falling down in between. But I am, you know, now at least clear that there is a possibility to walk, right, on two legs. So I have that confidence. I have that clarity. And therefore, I will keep making efforts. And if I keep making effort, it will be possible for me to walk on two legs. It will be possible for me to live with this awareness, with this acute awareness every moment, right? Every moment being aware of my feeling without reaction. Every moment finding out whether this feeling is naturally acceptable to me or not naturally acceptable to me. Every moment verifying that a natural feeling leads to harmony and happiness. An unnatural feeling leads to disharmony and unhappiness. Every moment I can see that if I have the feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, I am in a state of harmony within and happiness within. Even for a moment, if I have a feeling which is in contradiction with this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, I am in a state of contradiction within and unhappiness within. I can also see that if I can ensure this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence at this moment of time, I can ensure being harmony and happiness within at this moment of time. And if I can see this Right. I have at least had the glimpse of this possibility of living with awareness, living with natural feeling, living with feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, and therefore living with, you know, a state of harmony and happiness within. And then I can keep working on it. So this is what we have been trying to do in exercise one, from step one to step seven. And if you look at this whole thing, you know, all this can be summed up in step one. So if I'm doing step one properly and consistently, we can see that other steps are included in it. But it is important to work out these, you know, different steps in the beginning, because otherwise it will be all jumbled up. You will not be able to trace what you have to do at the beginning and how you have to go forward step by step. So we have tried to identify these steps which may be useful for us, given our conditions, you know, our state of being. So they seem to be useful steps. But as we said in the beginning, that this is one set of steps which can be used for being aware of oneself, right? Being aware of the state of oneself, the feeling of oneself, the thought of oneself, the understanding of oneself, and then slowly working on to understand what feelings are natural to me, and then ensuring those natural feelings and the thoughts which are based on these natural thoughts. And that will lead to a state of harmony and happiness. So these steps are, you know, one way of going about it, as we mentioned in the beginning. But the essential thing is this: I have to be aware of myself, aware of my feeling, aware of my sanskar, understanding or the presumption, preconditioning. Then I have to understand all this relationship, harmony and coexistence. And with that understanding, I have to ensure this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence. And if I do that, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness at this moment, next moment and every moment. So the essential thing to do is to be aware of the self, to be aware of the feeling of the self, the thought of the self, to be aware of the understanding or a sense of it, the self, and then to be aware of developing this understanding, this realization of relationship, harmony and coexistence, to be aware of ensuring this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, to be aware of the thought of this relationship, harmony and coexistence. And if I can do this, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness. That is the essential thing. But after a lot of interaction with people around, we try to work out some of these steps, and these are the seven steps that we worked out, which proved to be useful steps. But as we said, these are not the only steps or only set of steps. This is one set of steps which can be useful. So this is what we thought will be useful to propose. And we have started working on it. We have listened to the proposal. We have been, you know, working on it. We have started paying attention, you know, and at least we are able to get some feel of it, most of us. But certainly it is a long way to go. So this is what I had to sum up about exercise one 7 steps and particularly the first step. So I'll stop this English session with this conclusion from my side. From tomorrow, we can start this interaction of the self with the body. That is exercise 2, we can start working on. But I thought that this sum up may be useful for you. So I've done that. It takes 5 minutes to sum up this English session, from tomorrow, then Pramila ji will continue with this exercise 2. So I just have to mention that, from all that we have done in exercise 1, one thing comes very clear to us, or at least it should come very clear to us, that we have to be with the self and work with the self, right? Our existence as a human being has to be centered around the self and not around the body or physical facility, right? Because the body and the physical facility is on the periphery. So I am at the center. The self is at the center. The consciousness is at the center. Right. And therefore, I have to focus on myself. Right. I have to focus on the self. I have to focus on the consciousness. I have to work with the consciousness. I have to set things, in order there, in harmony there. And once that happens, then as and when required, I interact with the body, I interact with the world outside. Right? So only when I am in harmony, I can meaningfully relate to the body, I can meaningfully relate to other human beings, I can meaningfully relate to the rest of the world. So this is something which I have to keep in mind. Right? That I am central to my existence as a human being. Right? And therefore, I have to be aware of myself every moment. I have to work with myself every moment. Every moment I have to see that the feeling I have is in me is a natural feeling, a feeling which is naturally acceptable and not otherwise. Every moment I have to see that with that feeling, I'm in a state of harmony and happiness with him. So that I have to keep doing every moment. And that is the central thing for me to do as a human being. Now with this awareness, with this evaluation, with this, ensuring harmony and happiness within, now I can interact with the world outside. First, I can interact with the body as and when required. And similarly, I can interact with the world around, the other human being or anything else, right? As and when required. So I am centered around my own self. I am working with my own self. I am aware and I am evaluating myself every moment and ensuring this harmony and openness every moment. So this is what we have to do, and this I can do directly without referring to the body. Without referring to the body. In fact, one of the reasons why we took this exercise 1 as self, observing the self, because we wanted to have this clarity that as far as self is concerned, it is the self which is an observer. Right? And if I have to observe the self, I can observe the self directly without referring to the body. So we have worked through this exercise and we are able to see that, yes, in the self, is observing the self directly, and I can observe myself, I can evaluate myself, I can make sure that I have this feeling which is natural to me, and with that I am in a state of harmony and happiness. All this I can do myself at the level of self without referring to the body. So this we have to keep doing every moment, and with this going on in me, this process of observing the self by the self and ensuring the harmony within, Now I can interact with the body as and when I think it is necessary to interact with the body. So I don't have to unnecessarily keep, you know, interfering with the working of the body, which we keep doing presently. Like, as and when required, okay, I have to pay attention to the body, like while being aware, you know, myself within. So I can pay attention to the body. And when I pay attention to the body, I can decide, you know, what to do with the body, how to interact with the body, what kind of instructions to be given, what kind of sensations to be raised from the body. But this is once in a while, as and when required, not continuously. Right? So, with this awareness of the self and with this assurance of harmony in the self, I can now interact with the body as and when required, as and when I feel necessary. And similarly, we can interact with the world outside as and when necessary. But both this interaction with the body and the interaction with the world outside is going to be very temporary, very limited in time. But we will do that as well. So what we intend to do in exercise 2 is to essentially see this interaction with the body, interaction with the rest of the world as and when we feel it is necessary. But at the center of it is my awareness of myself, my ensuring the right feeling, the natural feeling in myself, my being in harmony and happiness. That is at the center, and with that, you know, as and when required, I can interact with the body, I can interact with the world outside. And that is what we will try to understand in exercise 2. So with this, I will stop this English session.